be about what is economics. The basic definition of kind of what it is that we're going to be really studying this semester, and looking at what really defines. When you think about when someone asks you, what do you know about economics? The most common response is, well, it's money or the economy. But it really goes so much more basic than that. And it has more real-time application to you as an individual and a consumer. So it's not just that big question kind of thing of money and the economy, but it can go deeper down into how do you make your decisions. So it comes all to scarcity and choice. It basically is this idea of needs and wants, and the fact that you can't have everything you need or want. No matter how much you want to tell yourself that you really do and can't have everything you need and want, you really can't. So we really need to look down and define what is a want and a need. So we're gonna get our little pen here because Miss Mason is also really bad at typing. Because look right here, it should be right here. Haha, not right here. What do you know? So a need is something that is necessary for survival. And that is, you cannot live without it. We always like to say that, I need this. Yeah, well, I need a pair of Louboutins, but you don't see me walking around in those red bottoms. Oh, that is something I really, really need. Really comes down to, you can't survive without these three things: air, food, shelter. H2O, you can only go so many days without water, but you can go your lifetime without owning a pair of Louboutins. Once, that's where I'd put these red bottom shoes. Oh, they're so beautiful. I would just work on my calves just to have a pair of those shoes and be able to wear them without falling. Or a Tesla, that'd be nice. I can really want these items and my desire might be really high, but I don't need them to survive. And I've shown that very well. So it's basically deciding, do we go with our want or do we go with our need? How do we decide between the two? And making the choices between them. And that's what we define economics. Economics is literally the study of how people make choices. So why do you have to make a choice? Why can't I have, you know, the things that I need for survival, like air, food, and shelter, and still have my Louboutins? Scarcity is the reason we can't have everything we need and everything we want. There is a finite quantity of resources on this earth. They're limited. There's literally an end to these resources. But everyone's wants and needs are unlimited. I have wants and needs. You watching this video has wants and needs. Then we produce little beings that have wants and needs, and therefore this is a continuing ongoing thing. And imagine the billions of people that live on this planet, trillions even, and how many wants and needs they all have. But there's only so many resources to meet the needs of every single being that has, will, or ever lived on this earth. So economists are basically all about trying to solve the problem of scarcity and meet these wants and needs. And they do that through goods and services. So you have goods, which are physical options, shoes, shirts, everything you're wearing, Louboutins, and then services, actions, activities. So you have like people who give haircuts, dental checkups, teaching you through this video, in which definitely doesn't provide for Louboutins. So whereas it might seem that there is an abundance of these goods and services, you go to a mall and you can see store after store with all of these things present. But if anything from the 2020 toilet paper shortage can teach us, is that those shelves are not always full. So shortage is a word I just mentioned, but how does that compare to scarcity? They're not the same thing. A shortage is when producers will or cannot offer goods and services at a certain price. For some reason, many people have their theories and many people have tried to answer this question of why did everyone need toilet paper in the March of 2020? They're all insufficient, if you ask me. But the story is short. There, it wasn't on the shelves all the time. It came, it went, but there was there's an end to this insight. And we see toilet paper now. The one thing I really need to come back is Clorox wipes. Temporary. It can be long-term. It just depends on basically what is the cataclysmic event that leads to the shortage or whatever. But it has an end. But scarcity will never, ever end. And that is because these resources on this earth literally have a finite quality. So scarcity always exists. This graphic here, just to kind of share the difference between this cookie, that is a shortage, which is a really sad existence to have when you have a shortage of cookies. But something that would be maybe a scarcity is the things that went into making the cookie that came from the earth and the land and the flour and, you know, those kind of things, which are going to cause maybe a drop in cookie production, which would make me very sad. So when we think about what scarcity applies to, it has to do with what we call factors of production. And factors of production is really going to be referred to many times in economics. And there are anything that goes into goods and services. It's really the base elements that go into a good or service that is going to be categorized as a factor of production. And we categorize them in three basic categories: land, labor, capital. So land is defined as all natural resources. It's literally found in nature, untouched, organic, found in nature. Fertile land for farming, products in or on the land, like a cow. So you have natural resources like coal, of course, water, trees, forest, cows, certain livestock, and of course, all the elements that are within those and in the land. Labor, that of course is the physical effort that people put into certain goods and services. So the medical aid, tightening of a clamp, an assembly line, artist creations, repairing a television, those are all labor. Capital, then, is the human resources to produce a good or service. So, you know, a bucket that you put the milk in when you milk the cow. The milk is the good, the bucket is the capital, and the cow, well, cow can be pretty much land. And then the laborer is the person that milked the cow. So capital comes in two different forms, and I'll define these a little bit further in just a second, but you have physical capital and human capital. So let's define physical capital. Physical capital is all these human-made objects. So like that bucket, or the fence that fenced in the cow, or the stool that the person sits in, or the barn that the cow was housed in, or, you know, the hay that they bought that was cropped from the land, because now when you then sell it, it can get pretty complicated. But basically, it's produced good that you use to produce another good. Buildings and tools. Investing in physical capital can come with a few benefits. You can basically make something more time efficient in production. You can create more knowledge of understanding how to do it. So a good example would be you have an assembly line and you're creating shirts, and you have three workers trying to make one shirt all by hand. So one person sews the sleeves, one person puts on, you know, puts those on the shirt, and then another person puts on the buttons. Well, then if you were to invest in a sewing machine, you can take all those three people, give them a sewing machine, and instead of taking hours for those three people to produce like 10 shirts, each person, each worker can produce more than 10 shirts in an hour by using each a sewing machine. So not only do you create more by investing in that sewing machine, but now the workers all have knowledge of how to sew with the sewing machine. So that creates a better productivity of your production. Human capital is slightly different because it's then the know-how to produce their skill or their good or service. So I invested in human capital in getting my education to be a teacher. And as this last year, I have taken many courses to increase my human capital in understanding teaching online. Those are investing in human capital. And those things can invest and can produce better workers, better quality of good or service. It can increase efficiency because let's say that those workers didn't know how to use a sewing machine. Well, you got to teach them, right? So now they're better at using the sewing machine. So when we think about taking all of these natural resources and solving this problem of scarcity for people's wants and needs, you need people who are understanding where the need or the want is, gathering up all these factors of production and producing the good or service that fulfills the want or need. So you have entrepreneurs, and they are the ones that are there to recognize. You've got, you know, Bill Gates with computers, and you have Elon Musk and Teslas, and you have these people who saw a want or need, whether they are really, really a need or if they just be really a want, and they fulfilled it by creating a new good or service with the factors of production. Entrepreneurs are essential in economics because of that way that they are developing original ideas, they're getting businesses, they're getting goods and services into the hands of people and creating economic growth. So no matter what choice you make in economics, no matter what you try to fulfill, whether it is that want, Louis Vuitton's, or whether it is the need, food, you are operating at all through a scarcity and through things that are scarce. And that is why we have to choose between one or the other. And so that is the basics of economics.